Osteochondral lesions of the talus is a bit a common condition when if you are doing seeing lots of patients with foot and ankle problems, definitely you will see a good number of patients having this problem. First, we are going to talk about the anatomy of the articular surface of the talar dome. Nearly 60% of the articular surface of the talus is covered by articular cartilage. As you know, it's sharing in the ankle joint or tibio-talar joint, sharing in the talonavicular joint, and it's sharing in the subtalar or talocalcaneal joint. All these are covered by articular surface. And the cartilage, as you all know, is composed from chondrocytes, which are the cells, plus the extracellular matrix. And the extracellular matrix of the cartilage has got 75% of its content water. It's a bit hydrous content, giving it a very good elastic elastic properties. In addition to collagen fibers, it is here type 2 collagen, as you can see, at giving it a good of possibility to withstand stresses and axial loads to this cartilage. Under this articular cartilage, you find a layer of compact bone supporting the cartilage and the intrabecular bone underneath. For the ankle joint, it is a highly congruent joint, with the average thickness of the cartilage of the talar dome nearly 1.1 millimeter. It's a bit more in men, but it is, compared to the knee, actually, it is a bit nearly half the thickness of the knee, the articular cartilage of the knee. However, because why this? Because, you know, the ankle is a very highly congruent joint, which means that the loads are equally distributed. So the amount of load is equal along different parts of the joint. If you talk about the knee, you'll find some areas which are taking very high stresses, like opposite the femoral condyles, and some areas with not so much stresses getting this. However, the cartilage of the ankle joint has got a very good tensile properties, which gives it a very good ability to absorb very amount of high loads. For your knowledge, the talus carries loads up to nearly four times the body weight during walking. Can you imagine four times? Because if you compare the body weight to the small surface area of the cartilage of the talar dome, you can imagine the amount of load which is concentrated on this articular surface. Because of this high congruency of the joint, if you have a small shift, just 1 millimeter lateral talar shift, this would reduce the contact area by nearly 42%. If you have 2 millimeter lateral shift, it reduces the contact area by more than half, nearly 56%, which is, means that the ankle is not very forgiving. If you do not have a perfect reduction and perfect allocation of the talus in its position, if it is moving just a few millimeters, 1 millimeter, 2 millimeters away from its proper position, this will allow major changes in the contact areas, and this would lead to very development of osteoarthritis. For the epidemiology of the osteochondral lesions of the talus, it is the third most common lesion after the knee and the elbow. However, this is a very commonly misdiagnosed or undiagnosed. The rate of delayed diagnosis or misdiagnosis more than 80%. So 80% of osteochondral lesions of the talus can pass undiagnosed. Can you imagine that? Because you need to have a very high index of suspicion to get to diagnosis of this condition. The etiology of osteochondral lesion can be traumatic or other lesions. Trauma is the most common cause. If you have an osteochondral lesion of the medial border of the talar dome, commonly this is due to varus or supination injury. If you have it on the lateral border, which is less common, it's a valgus or pronation injuries. Other causes which might lead to osteochondral lesions of the talus might be altered ossification, some intrinsic weakness of the cartilage or of the supporting underlying subchondral bone, avascular necrosis of the supporting bone, of the subchondral bone, maybe some spontaneous necrosis, malalignment, some patients taking steroids, or some thromboembolic manifestation, endocrine, or genetic factors. However, the abnormal alignment of the ankle joint can be a major predisposing factor for osteochondralosis. If we talk about the pathology, we have an injury to the cartilage and subchondral plate injury. For the cartilage, if you have a partial thickness injury, I mean that just a bit of the cartilage, not the whole surface of the cartilage injured, no potential of healing because it's not has no access for the blood supply. But if you have a full thickness injury of the cartilage, then the cartilage, the subchondral bone will be exposed. And this will allow the osteogenic cells and other mesenchymal cells to make a fibrocartilage repair. The repair is not going to be by the same high quality, high aligned cartilage. The repair will be by fibrocartilage. For the subchondral plate injury, you can have damaged subchondral bone is less able to support and overlying the cartilage repair. So you might end up with having some cysts or very areas of loss of the subchondral bone underneath the cartilage of the talus. Some association might be because of the, as you can see from here, the synovial fluid, if you have a partial tear of the cartilage or small tear, the cartilage will act as like a pump or like a valve, which allowing the fluid or the synovial fluid to flow. If you are having axial load, the fluid will flow this directly under from the cartilage inside the bone core, creating the cyst. And if you unload the cartilage, then the valve will close, allowing the pressure to increase inside the subchondral cyst. So you can imagine this to be like a valve in here with the water or the synovial fluid passing from one side and going to the from the surface, going to the subchondral bone, but not being allowed to return back to its place, creating this cyst formation, as you can see. For the classification, there are so many classification systems. One of them, the oldest or the classic one, is the Brent and Hardy classification based on the X-ray finding, where you are having one lesion is just undisplaced or lesion which is here just bone marrow or cartilage loss or some areas of rarefaction. Here there's partial separation of the osteochondral fragment. Type 3 is complete separation, but it's kept in place, and type 4 with a displaced osteochondral fragment. Frakel classification is based on the CT scan with the type 1 cystic lesion of the Taylor dome, but with intact roof. Type 2A is a cystic lesion with communication to the Taylor dome surface. Type 2B is open articular surface lesion with overlying undisplaced fragment. When you go to type 3, it is undisplaced lesion with some lucency, and type 4, which is the bottom right, is displaced osteochondral fragment. Another classification based on the MRI, which is proposed by Heppel et al., divided into five stages. Stage 1 is articular cartilage damage only. You can see it here. Type 2A cartilage injury with underlying fracture and surrounding bony edema in the middle here. Type 2B is stage 2 without surrounding bony edema. So the surrounding bony edema starts to resolve in stage 2B. Stage 3 is detached but undisplaced fragment, osteochondral fragment. Stage 4 is detached and displaced fragment. And stage 5 is subchondral cyst formation, not communicating with the articular surface. For the clinical picture, you always, for the history, the patient gives you a history of insidious or acute onset of pain in the ankles, maybe clicking or popping sensation if you have this loose fragment inside the joint. These loose bodies might cause even some locking if it is just moving freely inside the cartilage. When you examine the patient, you might find some swelling, local swelling. Cryptos might be present. Some pain might be increased with tibial talar compression as you do axial compression of the talus, but it's not very conclusive actually. The main clue for you is a high index of suspicion. It should be always be kept in the back of your mind in patients with severe long-standing ankle pain following ankle sprains. The pain gives a history of sprain or multiple sprain, and then persistent ankle pain, which is not being relieved by the usual conservative measures. When we come to radiographic assessment, the plain X-rays, anthroposterior lateral mortis view can be seen. I usually like to have weight-bearing films, but it can show you only if you have bony injuries, but you cannot actually use them for diagnosing purely cartilage injury. The CT scan sometimes adds to your diagnosis, but again, it might not give you a good clue about the state of the cartilage or the presence of bone marrow edema. But the MRI, it's very sensitive, can to detect even stage one with subchondral injuries with high sensitivity for detecting bone changes, which might suggest like bone marrow edema and surrounding soft tissue edema. This can be helpful. So the MRI can be very helpful tool for you. For the assessment, you can look at either unstable lesion, or you might have like an osteochondral fragment, which might be floating or moving inside the joint. There's sometimes instability in the MRI images. If you look and find them in the MRI, can give you that this lesion is potentially unstable. Like if you have a high signal, thin line at the interface of the normal bone and the lesion, or if you have a high signal curve linear focus 5 millimeter or more in diameter as the interface of the, in the normal bone or and the lesion. If you have a focal articular surface defect 5 millimeter or maybe more, so the defect is more than 5 millimeter, it can be an indication for instability. And another indication is the high signal line traversing the cartilage and subchondral bone plate into the lesion, indicating that the fluid has gone through this line. For other diagnostic tools, bone scan is a bit more specific. It just can give you and a clue about the presence of the healing potential of the lesion. When you come to the treatment, what's your aim first? Your aim is to relieve the pain. The patient is coming complaining from pain. You need to relieve his pain. You need to get him back to what he is used to do, to usual functions, and to have this treatment for a long time. And as usual, you have a non-operative and operative treatment. For the conservative treatment, it might be indicated for asymptomatic lesions, which are discovered just by incidence. If you are there, you're having MRI for another lesion, you find this Taylor osteochondral lesion, or sometimes in acute stage one and stage two lesions, which are early. For the conservative treatment, the patient can be immobilized in a non-weight bearing like walking boot or cast for up to 6 weeks. You can give some non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and then gradually you start gradual putting weight and gradual weight bearing with physiotherapy. It can give you, this conservative can give you some pain relief, but there is no guarantee that this is going to be long-lasting pain relief. So it has nearly 50% rate in systematic review by Zengrinich et al. In early lesions, early, very light lesions, but usually in the conservative treatment is very unpredictable. For the operative treatment, we're going to talk about the indications, the surgical approaches, some techniques, biological augmentation using concentrated bone marrow aspirate or platelet-rich plasma, and the post-operative care. For the operative treatment, you have got very wide list of options. And for each patient, you need to select the one which is really most suitable for this patient. It's what we call like a la carte selection of treatment for the patient. So you can do either drilling with microfracture, you can do mesenchymoplasty and autologous chondrocyte transplantation, osteochondral allograft transplantation, autologous chondrocyte implantation, matrix-induced autologous chondrocyte implantation, particulated juvenile articular cartilage allograft transplantation, bone grafting, excision, excision or priority, and fixation. The indications for open treatment usually in advanced cases like type 3 and type 4 lesions, and you can get it through either ankle arthroscopy or open surgery. For the ankle arthroscopy, you can put the patient like this. Either the foot is just bent at the knee with some distraction, or sometimes you can just put the patient lying supine with the foot outside the table and just you can use your manual distraction. And you have several portals. The most commonly used is the anteromedial portal and the anterolateral portals, where you can get very good access to the inside. For the open surgery, actually, most of the Taylor dome lesion can be accessed by just doing just an anteromedial or anterolateral anterior approach for the ankle, but it is a bit behind or hidden under the medial malleolus. Sometimes we might need to do osteotomy of the medial malleolus, osteotomy of the lateral malleolus, or even anterior osteotomy. For the osteotomy of the medial malleolus, you do just an incision centered over the medial malleolus, you need to identify and protect the tibialis posterior tendon, do some pre-drilling for later placement of the medial malleolar screw, as you can see here, and then Kirchner wire define the trajectory of the osteotomy. So you can some drills by Kirchner wire to know the site of the osteotomy. Then you can use a mini saw, but the saw do not go to the end of the osteotomy. Just do at the beginning, and as you approach, then use the usual osteotome so that the saw will not injure the articular surface of the talus. And then you reflect the osteotomy, and you can have a very good access of the anteromedial part of the medial part of the talar dome. If you have a lateral lesion, you can do a lateral malleolar osteotomy, where you can do a curved incision over the fibula, do pre-drilling of the fibula with oblique osteotomy of the fibula, as you can see in here, and then you can reflect the fibula. Sometimes anterolaterally, you can reflect part of the tibia, which like a flap of the tibia based on the anterior tibiofibular ligament. It's called the Charcot lateral tibial osteotomy. And sometimes this is very uncommonly used, which is an osteotomy of the anterior central lesion, where you can have like a, take like a bulk of quadrangular area or of the anterior part of the plafond, and then take it out or reflect it, and you can see the superior surface of the talus. But I can find this is to be very aggressive. Next for the technique, now you have done the approach. First is drilling and microfractures. It can used to be smaller lesions up to 15 millimeters in diameter, where you do multiple holes in the subchondral plate, the distance between the holes 3 to 4 millimeters interval. This allows the release of the mesenchymal cells, growth factor, fibrocartilaginous repair. But when you drill the hole, you need to see, if you do it arthroscopy, you need to feel the fat globules coming down from the bone marrow to indicate that you had reached the proper area of the bone. You can see here, there is a drilling with microfracture. We are using here Stedman peg. You can use a Kirchner wire with the multiple drills here. And it, but know that this is going to fill up with fibrocartilage. Of course, this drilling, I usually do it arthroscopically, but sometimes you can do transmalleolar drilling by KY insert through the medial malleolus and go through there. Or retrograde drilling, if you have a lesion or a cyst which is not reaching the articular surface, I use the KY here, which is going towards the lesion. I check the position by imaging, and then I do my drilling. And sometimes you can put a bone graft, or like you can inject bone graft through this tunnel in order to fill up the defect. Mosaicoplasty and autologous chondrocyte implantation is used mainly for large lesions, more than 1.5 or 2 millimeters in diameter. The autologous graft is similar in biological and mechanical properties. You usually take it from the near medial surface of the lateral condyle, so it contains hyaline cartilage, and you need to have the chisel or the harvesting chisel was 1 millimeter the greater diameter than the recipient bone. You can see here the areas where you are taking the donor areas, and then you just hammer it and fill it up in the defect that you have created. But of course, if you have a shoulder lesion, you might have some difficulty in using the mosaicoplasty because you cannot have a graft which is taking the contour of the shoulder or the talus. So this is a case which you have got this large subchondral cyst with the last osteochondral lesion of the talus. This is a transmedial malleolar osteotomy done. You can see the tibialis posterior tendon, and this is the surface of the talus here with the chondral defect. Then preparation of the surface you can do by this drilling or special instrument, which can drill it. And then we opened in the knee, small incision, and we took the harvesting chisel, and we took our graft and we hammered it down into the surface of the talus. And you can see it here in place after harvesting it, and then the medial malleolar osteotomy has been done. Other things is osteochondral allograft transplantation taken from a cadaver. It has got some problems with immune rejection or disease transmission, so you need to be very careful. Here, a piece of the bone has been taken out, and this is taken from the allograft from a cadaver, and it's fixed in place. It can be fixed by screws or whatever. You can see here osteochondral graft and transplantation fixed by like Herbert screws. Another technique is autologous chondrocyte implantation, which is composed of two steps. First, you take the healthy articular cartilage is you take a biopsy and you take the chondrocytes harvested in a special culture for 11 to 21 days, and then you take this chondrocytes and implant it. Here you can see this is a technique for autologous chondrocyte implantation. If you have a defect like that, you just go down to the normal bone, fill up most of the defect with bone graft. And this is a sandwich technique where you are putting a layer of the periosteum in, and then another layer of the periosteum, and then you inject this syringe with chondrocytes, which has been harvested between the two layers, which is called sandwich technique. Matrix-induced autologous chondrocyte implantation, the chondrocytes are embedded in the matrix, and the matrix is secured in the defect with like a fibrin glue or a fibrin sealant, so you do not need to do fixation or sutures. The particulated juvenile articular cultured allograft transplantation, it's taken from embryos or newborn up to 2 years, and the chondrocytes have a higher ability to migrate and multiply because they are taking it very, a very chondrocytes with a very good, high good growth potential. This can be useful as well. For like a big osteochondral lesion or the, which can be fixed, you can use it like the Herbert screw or a pin by rod or by fibrin glue. So either you can do for the osteochondral lesion, you can do some bone grafting, you can do excision or excision and curettage for these defects which can face, and then you can cover them by whatever you find. Some biological augmentation can be used like concentrated bone marrow aspirate. It has got some bioactive cytokines and mesenchymal cells. Other suggestion for platelet rich plasma recently induced, but the long-term follow-up is not available, but definitely it includes a very good epidermal growth factor, fibroblast growth factor, transforming growth factor beta, vascular endothelial drive growth factor, a very good number of growth factors can be useful. For the post-operative cancer, there's no consensus or opinion for that. I prefer non-weight bearing for 4 to 6 weeks, and then gradual weight bearing, and allow full weight bearing only after healing of the osteotomy or after you are sure that the graft is taken on, which is usually not before 6 weeks. However, but you do not need to keep the patient immobilized. You can allow after 2 weeks or 3 weeks, the patient to start moving his ankle, but without weight bearing. But I wouldn't recommend weight bearing before 6 weeks. In summary, I just need to remind you that osteochondral lesions of the teres are common lesions, and the high index of suspicion is the key for diagnosing these kind of lesions. MRI scan is very useful in diagnosing this kind of lesion. Arthroscopy is a very useful tool for diagnosis and for management of these lesions. Conservative treatment sometimes can be helpful for early lesions, but for other lesions, small, if you have a small diameter, the first line is drilling. If there are big lesions, more than 2 millimeters, then you can think of, about mosaicoplasty, autogenous chondrocyte implantation, allograft. This can be useful for larger lesions. And thank you very much for your attention.